Good morning. Welcome to the Sunday TV breakfast session. We have Dr. Srimannarayana and Dr. Abhijit Sitole with us. And I would like to request Dr. Srimannarayana to start the session. Thank you so much.
Dr. Srimannarayana, sir, kindly unmute yourself, please.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, good morning, everyone, to Sunday morning TE session. Dr. Abhijit is assistant professor in JLD Medical College and consultant cardiac anesthetist. He will be speaking on TE in coronary artery disease. Dr. Abhijit, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for the kind introduction. Without wasting time, I will start my session. CABG is one of the most common types of surgery. And the assessment of the LV function or systolic function is the most common indication for the TE in a coronary artery bypass surgery. So assessment of the LV function is perhaps the most common indication performing a perioperative echo. LV function has consistently been shown to be a predictor of morbidity and mortality during the perioperative period. It has to be assessed even in a situation where it is not a primary focus of examination, like valves, assessment of the valves and all. LV systolic function assessment describes contractility of the LV. LV contractility is a load dependent. It follows the Frank star.
Yes, sir. Your slides are not visible, sir. Requesting you kindly share your slide once again, please.
One second. I have shared it, but I think it is on the other platform. This platform.
You can share once again.
One second. You have created one more of this one. Now am I audible? Now I am visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, slides will be closed, sir. Make it as a full screen, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now it is.
Perfect, sir.
Okay. Should I minimize now? No. Okay. So, LV assessment of the LV systolic function, perhaps the most common indication performing an echo. It has consistently been a predictor of morbidity and mortality. LV function assessment describes the LV contractility. Contractility of LV is always a load-dependent measure. So, it follows a Frank Starling's curve. So it should be assessed over a range of preloads and afterloads. With one individual value, you may not have a good assessment. American Society of Echocardiography recommends that every echocardiographic examination should include evaluation of the chamber size and its function for the clinical decision making. Perioperative TE is a class 2 or category 2 indication in a myocardial revascularization surgery. In brief, we know that there are two coronary arteries, left coronary artery and right left main divides into two. The left anterior descending follows the anterior interventricular groove, while the circumflex, it goes into the on the left side of the atrioventricular groove, and then it continues into the posterior interventricular groove if it is a left dominant circulation. While most of the cases, they have a right dominant circulation, where the right coronary artery passes anteriorly between the anterior and right side atrioventricular groove, and then it turns on the posterior aspect of the heart, and it gives the posterior descending artery into the posterior interventricular septum. So accordingly, the blood vessel supply will be there, and the regional, this is very important when you are dealing with the regional wall function and formulating the culprit vessel for the particular regional wall motion abnormality. So system dominance is defined by the artery which gives the rise to the posterior descending artery. PD arises from the RCA in 65% of the patients. It is the right dominant circulation. Arises from 30% in patients in from the left circumflex, which is a left dominant circulation. In 5% patient, both two arteries run parallel to each other as a posterior descending artery. So they have a co-dominant circulation. The dominance is important during TE assessment for the regional wall function, which to identify the culprit, as I told, the culprit coronary responsible for the inferior wall motion. And it is very important to assess it pre and post grafting. and to see whether any new onset regional wall motion environment is there in a particular region. The left ventricle gets blood supply in diastole, while right ventricle gets blood supply both phases of the cardiac cycle. In brief, this is a systolic phase of the cardiac cycle. It extends 0.3 seconds. It has a isoelometric contraction, early rapid ejection, and late slow ejection. I am putting these two physiological things here because it has a very much correlation into for the assessment of the LV function when it comes to myocardial performance index estimation. There are some basic assumptions of the LV systolic function, where because LV is not a properly dimensioned like entity, we have to assume LV in a particular shape for evaluating the echocardiographic function or LV function. So we have a biplane ellipse model, we have a bullet model, we have a three-axis measurement, single plane long axis measurement, biplane long axis ellipse measurements. These are all assumptions on which the echocardiographic assessment is based. So the most common or the most frequently or most accurately say so-called measure is a area length geometric models for calculating the left ventricular volumes. In that, biplane method of discs is a most accurately measures the LV function, and which has been recommended by the American Society of Echocardiography for the LV systolic function assessment. There are prolate ellipsoid models, that is single plane area length method. There are prolate ellipsoid models like biplane area length method, and then cylinder hemi ellipsoid or bullet formula method for the calculation of LV function. All this we should discuss in brief because you come to know which why exactly some methods are really been recommended and why some are not recommended by the Society of Echocardiography. So we'll just go one by one. So LV function, LV ejection fraction measurement by the linear measurement is we have a endocardial a fractional shortening, that is called as EFS. So it is a basically a single plane measure. So it is a M mode measurement done in transgastric mid short axis and or a two chamber views. Endocardium to endocardium distance is measured in end diastole and in end systole, and the fractional shortening is given by formula of internal diameter in diastole minus LV internal diameter in systole divided by internal diameter in diastole into 100. So normal value for men is 25 to 43%, for women it is 27 to 45%. It is a 2D time. It is very important to adjust the 2D time and the lateral gain before M mode and overall gain after putting a M mode to accurately detect the endocardial and epicardial borders. So these are the normal values of the fractional shortening and the EF measured by the linear measurement. So you know all these normal and abnormal values. I will not talk much on it. So this is how it is done. So in transgastric mid short axis at the level of papillary muscles, you take M mode measurement, and you should adjust your gain, M mode gain, and the 2D gain properly to detect the endocardial borders. You have to exclude the papillary muscle linear cuts which are coming in the view. And if you measure the end diastolic diameters in and in systolic diameters, you get a fractional shortening. So I have kept an image moving in between, so you can correlate this LV function. It is a severe regional wall motion abnormality, and you have a fractional shortening of 17.4%. So this is a depressed LV which has been shown here. So this comes in a category of moderately dysfunctional LV. Now, for the same M mode, we can do a LV function or LV EF measurement by using our Tekoe's method. It is based on the prolate ellipsoid assumption of ejection fraction measurement. It is a linear measure. So, if the machine software gives you a additional benefit of calculating the LVEF by Tekoe's method, just we have to see the systolic and diastolic thickenings of the posterior wall of the LV. if we put the cursors properly on the endocardial thickening in the diastole and in the systole, the machine calculates the LVEF. For the same patient, we have a LVEF of 35.9% by the Teclo's method. It's in the moderate category. So pitfalls of the M-mode measurement: non-perpendicular alignment of the M-mode line in relation to the long axis of the LV. This leads to overestimation of the ventricular dimensions. Two-dimensional guided M-mode measurement can aid proper alignment, thereby minimizing the error. So always look at the image which is there on the upper part of your screen to adjust the proper alignment of the axis. Inaccurate identification of the endocardial and epicardial borders has a confusion arises from the contiguous structures like chordae, trabeculations near the posterior wall, and the false tendons. The endocardial border is distinguished from the trabeculations and chordae by its appearance as a continuous line of the reflection throughout the cardiac cycle, while papillary muscles and other structures will have intermittent appearance during the systole and diastole. M-mode measurements are valid only when LV geometry is normal. This is very important. In presence of the gross regional wall motion abnormalities in the line of axis will definitely cause the reading which is not been a very proper reading. When LV geometry is abnormal and aneurysmal remodeling or in presence of regional wall motion abnormality following infarction, M-mode measurements are misleading. M-mode measurements cannot be used in LV dyssynchrony for the calculation of LVEF. An extensional relationship exists between the ventricular diameters and the ventricular volume. So M-mode parameters of LV systolic function are dependent on ventricular loading conditions. Coming to the LV ejection fraction estimation by planimetric method, that is a two-dimensional method. Most commonly used is LV fractional area change. So two-dimensional measures of area is done in transgastric mid-short axis view. Endocardial borders tracing is done in end diastole and end systole. Papillary muscles are included in the area of trace, and as it is a intracavitary structures. So the fractional area change is given by again the formula internal LV internal area in diastole minus systole systolic area divided by LV internal area in diastole into 100. Normal values for male is 56% to 62%. For women it is ranges 59 to 65%. It is also a load dependent measure. Values varies with the level of short axis where you are cutting the transgastric mid-short axis view or the LV. So range is 36 to 62%, and it is 40% when you are cutting in the basal, 50% for the mid, and 60% for the apex. So as you go from base towards the apex, the range increases, or the FAC increases, which comes in the normal range. So time gain and lateral gain settings are optimized to get uniform reflections of the endocardium. Automated border detection can also be applied if available in the modern machine. Good correlation was found between the radionuclide EF estimation and the fractional area measurement by some studies. So this is how it is done. Again, it is a transgastric mid-short axis. We have freeze the frame in diastole and in the systole. We are traced the endocardial border using the machine software. And it gives you a fractional area change, that is LV internal area in diastole minus systole divided by diastolic area into 100. It comes around 19.4%. LV ejection fraction by volumetric assessment is rather the most commonly used method for accurately assessing the LV function. We have a cuboid method, which is a linear measurement. Here, what we assume is LV is a symmetrical ellipse in one major and two minor axis. If the major axis of minor axis of four chamber and two chamber is assumed the same, then it becomes a two diameters, that means diameter square. So LV volume is given by the formula pi into d square into L by 6. This method is not recommended by the American Society of Echocardiography because there are chances of error in minor axis are not uniform overall in overall heart. Ejection fraction is given again by the same formula, LV end diastolic volume minus systolic divided by end diastolic volume into 100. So this is how it can be done. This is a mid-esophageal four chamber view obtained at 0 degrees, and you have a end diastolic frame and end systolic frame. We have a longitudinal length of the LV and we have a diameter of the LV. We are assuming here that two chamber and the four chamber diameters are minor diameters are same. So we have a formula. We have put the values into the formula. We have got the LVEF of 32.59% of the same patient. It is, I am doing it for the same patient to see how much difference exists between the cuboid methods and the most commonly recommended methods. So second common method is a bullet formula, or it is a single plane area length method, or planimetric. It is also a planimetric measure. Here the LV is assumed to be a bullet shape, that is one, it is achieved by joining a hemisphere and a cylinder. The volume of LV can be calculated by longitudinal area into length of the LV. So volume is given by 5 by 6 into area square divided by length into 100. So LV ejection fraction is again diastolic volume, systolic volume divided by diastolic volume into 100. This method is a second recommendation. Like first is a biplane method, that is Simpson's ellipsoid formula. And this one is a second method, which is recommended by the American Society of Echocardiography, because the bullet shape of the LV is like rather a very anatomical shape of the LV, if the chamber dimensions are good or there is no regional wall motion. So in case of LV aneurysm, dilated cardiomyopathies in severe forms of RWMA, bullet shape is deformed. So this method may be inaccurate in estimating those. So here how it is done, we have calculated the area of the LV in the diastole and area of the LV in the systole and the length of the LV in diastole and systole. If we put the same in the formula of the bullet, then it gives you a LVEF of 33.8%. Coming to the most commonly used modified Simpson's biplane method, it is a method of discs, and it is also called as a Simpson's method. It is based on the Simpson's rule that volume of the cavity is sum of volumes of a series of smaller slices of disc of equal thickness. Simpson's biplane method divides LV cavity into 20 discs of equal thickness. Surface area of each disc is measured using minor axis A and V in midesophageal 4 and 2 chamber wave respectively. Manual endocardial border detection is needed, that is modified planimetric algorithm in 4 chamber and 2 chamber in end diastole and end systole. Modern echo machines calculate orthogonal diameters of the disc by taking distances of the orthogonal intercepts. So this is what the summation formula for the all 20 areas, and EF is given by the differences in the volumes divided by diastolic volume into 100. So this is how the Simpson's biplane method is usually done. You have to identify the end diastolic frame, identify the end systolic frame, and you use the machine software which divides the LV cavity into 20 equal disc areas, and summation of all these disc areas into the length of that longitudinal length of the LV will give you a ejection fraction. Machine itself calculates the ejection fraction. We have to do it into 4 chamber wave and 2 chamber wave to get more accuracy, and this is what the LVEF is given. So here LVEF is coming as 42.2%. That is more logical if you look at the eyeballing of that particular LV. So same three different volumetric analyses give you three different results, but this seems to be a more accurate looking at the eyeballing of that particular LV. So this is done in a two chamber view. It is in exactly orthogonal plane. So volumetric method, modified Simpson's, it calculates the LV ejection fraction correctly in presence of regional wall motions. So preferred method for EF estimation in coronary arteries. ASC recommends this method as a gold standard. Simpson's method best correlates with angiographic and MRI derived LVEF compared to area length and cuboid methods. Foreshortening of the LV is very important. This should be avoided because it underestimates. Improper endocardial border detection will also wrongly calculate the EF. So foreshortening of the LV is avoided in 4 midesophageal 4 chamber view. We have to do 20 degrees retroflexion when you get a foreshortening so that the LV apex can be properly delineated. Mitral annular calcifications make endocardial border detection little difficult, and it can add to errors. Assumption of the LV length similar in two orthogonal plane can also not hold true in some situations like aneurysms. So these are the normal values of the LV function. Normal is more than 55% or equal to 55%. Mildly reduced LV function is 45 to 54%. Moderately reduced is 30 to 44%. Severely reduced LV is less than 30% of the LV. These are the normal ranges of the LV diastolic volumes, systolic volumes, and stroke volumes. Indexed diastolic volume is a very good predictor of long-term mortality and morbidity in cases of coronary artery disease, because the indexed anything which is indexed with the body surface area gives more better correlation with the outcomes than the individual or without using indexed areas or indexed volumes. Coming to the TDI is another modality for the assessment. TDI measures myocardial tissue velocities using low pass filters. It to record the myocardial velocities, gain settings are lowered, and temporal resolution is optimized by reducing the image sector, thereby increasing the frame rate. Smaller pulse wave volumes are placed on the lateral mitral annulus or a medial mitral annulus. Systolic mitral annular velocities are measured. Midventricular segment velocities and apical also can be measured to have an overall myocardial performance. Mitral annular velocity S prime is a quick and easy way to estimate LVF, especially when there is a poor window. For TE, it may not hold true, because in transthoracic most of the times you get a poor window. In absence of regional wall motion, lateral TDI of more than 7.5 to 8 represents LVF of more than 50%. That is a good LV function. If TDI S prime is less than 5.5, it represents LV failure, and S prime less than 3 centimeters per second is associated with significantly increased risk of cardiac death within 2 years. So this is why the TDI is important. In presence of RWMA, average of lateral, septal, anterior and posterior annular TDI can be considered to calculate the EF. The common formula or roughly estimation of EF is 8.2 plus 5.5 into the summation or the average of all the TDIs measured in anterior, posterior, lateral and medial annulus. This is a tissue Doppler velocity chart for the assessment of the LV function using the TDI. The lateral TDI is commonly used. 8.7 plus minus 2.4 is a healthy heart. Then septal TDI is a second commonly used, and third is the mitral annular submitral annular velocities on the lateral TDI as myocardial velocities. So these are the ranges for the TDI. This is how it is done. It's midisubfoveal four chamber view. You can put a color Doppler and then the pulse wave Doppler or a direct TDI settings if they are available in the machine. And you can see the mitral annular excursions there, lateral and the medial mitral annular excursions on the both images I have shown there. And this the downward deflection here, is a systolic motion of the annulus or the subannular myocardium. And medial S prime of more than, here it is almost 6.79, so it is a good LV. Here also it is 11.4, so this is a example of a good LV function. And I have shown the image in the middle, which confirms that it is a good LV function by eyeballing. So this is a patient with a poor LV. Here, if you can see, the lateral S prime is 4.53. So it is a poor LV because it is less than 5.5. And in the lateral S prime 5.5, here it is 5.04, it is a poor LV. So peak systolic annular velocity is greater compared to the mid systolic velocities. The SM velocity is better representative of overall LV systolic function than SA. They are age dependent and gender dependent. TDI underestimates the velocities of the Doppler beam, is not aligned parallel to the movement of the tissue. Tethering effect of adjacent segments will overestimate the TDI velocities. Coming to the myocardial performance index, though it is not a pure estimation for the LV systolic function, it gives you overall performance of the heart, both systolic and diastolic. It is calculated as a ratio of sum of isolometric contraction and relaxation time to the ejection time. MPI considered systolic as well as diastolic phases of the cardiac cycle. This is the index of a global LV function. MPI is measured in two ways, by tissue Doppler imaging of the septal wall, that is the mitral, medial mitral annular velocities, that is TDI method, and second is a mitral inflow velocity method. This is pulse wave Doppler in midisubfoveal four chamber and LVOT, pulse wave Doppler in deep transgastric long axis view. It is a conventional method, but this method has a disadvantage because we are measuring in two different cardiac cycles. Here we are measuring it in one cardiac cycle, so this looks more appropriate than the other method. So the MPI is given by the formula of in isolometric contraction time plus relaxation time divided by the ejection time. The MPI below 0.39 plus minus 0.05 is considered normal, it increases with the LV dysfunction. So this is how it is done. There is a transgastric long axis view. We have put a pulse wave Doppler here, and we have got a VTI of LVOT. This considered as a ejection time, and the distance between the two diastolic waves, that is end of the A wave and starting of the E wave, is considered as A. And if we divide this A minus B divided by B, it is indirectly, it gives you a MPI. It is a 0.41 here. MPI by TDI method. This is more reliable and accurate method. Here we have a combined systolic and diastolic dysfunction will increase over, and it overestimates the MPI. Combined systolic and diastolic dysfunction will increase and overestimate the MPI in TDI. The prolongation of IVCT is observed in the systolic dysfunction, while IVRT is prolonged in early phases of diastolic dysfunction. Tachycardia may appear hamper the results of TDI. These are the drawbacks of the TDI method. How it is done? In the lateral mitral annulus, we have put the TDI, and in TDI, we are calculating the isolometric contraction time, isolometric relaxation time, and the ejection time. So here we are giving a direct calculations by measuring the direct values of IVCT, IVRT, and ejection time. Here it is coming as a 0.6. So this is a normal LV, because here LVEF is almost 58%, and see the value of MPI, it is 0.4. This is a poor LV, dilated LV. Here the value of MPI is 0.95. So it correlates well with the LV ejection fraction. Rate of ventricular pressure rise. This is another method used for assessment of the LV contractility, LVDP by DT. LVDP by DT correlates directly with the contractile force. Mitral regurgitation is a prerequisite for the LVDP by DT assessment. MR continuous wave Doppler allows calculation of instantaneous pressure gradient between the LA and LV. LA pressure change is in early systole is considered negligible. So rising segment of the MR jet velocity during isolometric contraction should essentially reflect the LV pressure rise. In poor LV, the rise of ventricular pressure will be reduced, so the rate of ventricular pressure rise also will reduce. That is a basic principle for the LVDP by DT assessment. So rate of ventricular pressure rise is measured as a time taken from velocity change of 1 meters to 3 meters per second. Bernoulli's principle is used, that is delta P is equal to 4 V square. Slight modification of Bernoulli's equation gives you LVDP by DT by dividing this velocities 3 meters per and 1 meters per second square. And the LVDP by DT is given by the formula 36 milliliters of mercury divided by DT. This is how it is. It should be done. This patient has a grade 1 MR, though it is not shown here. There was a grade 1 MR, and if we put a continuous wave Doppler exactly parallel to the flow of the blood, that is the central MR jet, we are getting a continuous wave Doppler of a MR trace, and we are measuring the velocity from 1 meters per second to 3 meters per second. And this slope is being calculated here, and machine itself can diagnose the LVDP by DT as 113. In this patient, it is 1136 millimeters of mercury per second. The values here are more than 1200 is normal. Borderline is 800 to 1200. Reduced DP by DT is less than 800, and time of more than 32 milliseconds to achieve that, and severely reduced is less than 500. Inotropic support increases LVDP by DT, preload dependent measure, and accuracy is questionable when there is a severe MR. Assessment of the LV systolic function by strain and strain rate. So I'll take another 5 minutes to cover this. Myocardial strain and strain rate are extrapolation of the TDI technology. The strain measures magnitude of the segmental myocardial deformation during systolic from its baseline, that is end diastole. It is expressed as a percent change in the value from the baseline. Strain rate denotes the rate of this segmental myocardial deformation during the systole against the time. Strain and strain rate correlates well with the radionucleoid MRI, Simpson's, and TDI derived LVEF. The changes in preload, afterload, and myocardial stenting and stiffness directly influences the myocardial strain. It is not a real-time assessment. Strain calculation is done as post-processing analysis as recorded 2D image, so it is a time-consuming. So this is a basic principle, the initial length and the final length. divided by the initial length into 100, it gives you the strain. There are three types of strain: radial, circumferential, and longitudinal strain. The radial strain is towards the center of the LV. The circumferential is a twisting and turning force, while longitudinal strain happens from the base to the apex of the LV. So the normal readings of the circumference tails are in the minus, while radial is a plus, and in the longitudinal tail again it is a minus. So ranges are -20, -20 for longitudinal and circumferential, while +20 for the +40 for the radial strain. So the basal, this is important, basal rotation of the LV is usually clockwise, while apical rotation is a clockwise. That's why it creates a circumferential strain. These are the basic normal readings or ranges of the strain. Normal range of the global LV strain are for radial +40, -20 for circumferential, for longitudinal -20. This is how it is done. It is done in advanced 2DQ, in midesophageal 4-chamber, midesophageal 2-chamber views, where the speckle tracking is used, software is used to delineate the epicardial and endocardial borders, and the image is played, or the image is played and acquired, and it gives you a strain graphs over a period of time, time and the percentage of the strain. So it can, we have to go for the transgastric mid short axis and apical short axis to get the circumferential and the radial strains. So here in our patient, what we have done, the peak longitudinal strain is coming -7.3. In two chamber view, it is coming -7.1. Mid short axis circumferential is -14, while basal short axis it is -13. And EF of this particular patient is 41% and FAC is 38.7%. So it is a moderately dysfunctional LV, which strain also is showing the same result. After the strain, we get the bullseye. If we the software plots the bullseye, and it gives you overall strain of the all basal, mid and the apical segments. The circumferential strains values are in minus, radial strain values are in plus. If you can also get it into a time to peak the particular strain, the time taken for a particular myocardial speckle or myocardial velocity to reach its maximum strain, it also can be given in the bullseye. So it has a different interpretation. Some myocardial segments, those who are having regional myocardial motion, they will peak in a strain little later than those who are a good segment. So they will have a delay in peak. So this is what the importance of the time to peak is. So LVEF can also be estimated by 3DQ lab. And this is what the example of the same patient. Here the LVEF is coming as 37.48%. It is done in full volume acquisition of the LV. You go to the full volume, take the 4-bit acquisition, get the image playing, and then you work on that image through the QLab software or 3DQ software, and you can assess the LV function. This is better because it gives you the diastolic and systolic frames in only one cardiac cycle, and it gives you two orthogonal planes in one cardiac cycle. So you may not have a discrepancy of the two cardiac cycle preloads for the assessment. Coming to the systolic sphericity index, it is the last measure. I will cover the regional wall motion in next part. For this part, we will just talk on the global LV function. So this is the last aspect of the global LV function, that is a systolic and diastolic sphericity indices. Here, the assumption is the LV is compared with the equal diameter sphere of the volume of the sphere. So systolic sphericity index is a volume of the sphere divided by end systolic volume calculated by the biplane ellipse Simpson's method divided by the same diameter sphere. So the longitudinal length of the LV is considered as a diameter for the sphere. So the systolic and diastolic sphericity indices are calculated. The mean of these two sphericity indices, if it is more than 0.7, it correlates well with the LVEF of less than 30% and indexed LVEDV of 125 ml. So this is how the LV sphericity index can be done in diastole. we have done a diastolic frame, end-diastolic frame volume measurement, and if we calculate the volume of a sphere of a same diameter of a longitudinal length of the LV, we get a diastolic sphericity index of 0.6. In the second metasubfrangial four chamber view, we are seeing the longitudinal length of the LV. This length is used to calculate the volume of the sphere. Here, end systolic frame is there. We are calculated end systolic volume here, and end systolic length of the LV is calculated here. And if we get a volume of this sphere, and if we divide this particular end systolic volume by this sphere volume, we get a systolic sphericity index. Estimating cardiac output by TE, the cardiac output also is a good measure of assessment of the LV function, because it is basically what is needed for the patient. The cardiac output should be good. So it is done in metasubfrangial long transgastric long axis view, where LVOT Doppler is done, which is a parallel alignment to the LVOT, and VTI signals are seen, that is LVOT VTI. LVOT VTI is calculated. In metasubfrangial long axis view, we are getting the LVOT diameter, and you know the formula of stroke volume, LVOT area into LVOT VTI, and cardiac output is, if you multiply this by the heart rate calculated by the ECG, we get a cardiac output. In this patient, the cardiac output is 3.4 liters per minute. So contrast echo can also be used when you have a difficulty in endocardial border detection. This is especially done for the transthoracic echo. The segmental wall motion abnormality I will take into the next class, because we are running out of the time. I will directly skip to the last slide, that is take home message. So take home message is a perioperative TE is a in CABG can give apt information. Pre and post CABG LV systolic function adds to the clinical decision making, not only in OR but also in ITU, that is deciding about inotropic and vasoactive supports, mechanical cardiovascular supports, placement of IABP or ECMO. Studies have improvement in regional myocardial motion abnormality. CABG carries better post-operative course and survival than unchanged or deteriorated regional wall motion score. Contractility of LV is load dependent, and it ASC recommends Simpson's Bateman method for the assessment of LV. Volumetric analysis of LV is load dependent but still carries more weightage in clinical decision making. TIE index is a compound measure of systolic and diastolic function of the heart. So TE-derived cardiac output carries a chance of error, as stroke volume is measured in two different cardiac cycles, yet it has to be a value in clinical decision making. Strain and strain rate has a significant clinical in predicting the LV systolic dysfunction at the subclinical level, and more precise idea about segmental regional wall motion abnormality. All in all, we have to combine all the methods together to get to a clinical decision making while we are performing a TE in perioperative period of CABG, and come to a clinical decision making. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Hello.
Shriman.
Hello.
Shriman is available. Anyway, yes, thank sir. You, Abhijit, for that excellent presentation. It was well done.
Thank you, sir.
And if there are any questions, we'll see the chat box. This is no, I cannot make out any chat box questions. Nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
There's one comment. See, I just wanted to slightly modify our statement about Simpson's method.
Yes,
sir. You said that the discs of equal areas,
equal length, sir. Equal length, sorry.
Equal heights. It is equal heights.
Yeah.
Equal thickness or whatever, height, or it's not equal area. They are not equal because the area is not gas cylinder, it's a electrical structure.
Yes, sir, I apologize.
That's the comment I would like to make. Correct. And the sphericity index, the simplest way to do is just go to the longitudinal length and the lateral length, that is the what is called side to side length, and get the index. You related it to the volume.
Sir, eccentricity index is side to side for the assessment of RV function, sir. The sphericity index is something which is pertaining to the engine, sir.
Good morning,
sir.
Comments from the audience?
Good morning, sir. Sir, here in assessing the fractional shortening of the this one, even the velocity assessment of velocity also gives a good predictor of left ventricular function. What you feel, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Correct. The velocities of the myocardium.
Normally, up to what level can be taken as normal? And you understood my question?
Sir, can you repeat it? Which velocities you are talking, sir?
Shortening, fractional area shortening, even the velocity, it gives the this one, not only the area.
Velocity at which the area is shortening.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, correct. That is the basis of the strain and strain rate, basically. Mm. The advanced 2DQ softwares,
yes,
they measure this particular velocities in M mode. So color Doppler M mode TDI and color Doppler M mode in strain, that considers these particular velocities for the assessment of a particular regional wall motion.
These are recent.
Yeah, this is a recently been done.
And, in velocity strain, should be more than one.
Yes. 30. Nice, like it is like a regional wall motion shortening, yes, more than 30%. It correlates well with that. Even the radionuclide assay also confirms that this shortening and the area change is like a good in whenever there is no regional wall motion.
So what should be the eccentric sphericity you told for RV? What should be the value and what should be the cutoff point? It means what is the this one?
See, normally, this function and, eccentricity index when you are considering, this is like out of topic discussion, but it is
because okay. You told I'm asking.
This is a LV sphericity index, sir. This is not an eccentricity index.
No, I'm asking extra.
Eccentricity index is what? Normally, both the antero-posterior and the transverse diameters of the LV should be same if there is a RV function is good. Whenever there is a RV dysfunction, it presses on the septal wall of the LV because there is a ventricular interdependence. So what happens?
Paradoxical.
So the transverse length of the LV will become shorter than the longitudinal length of the LV, and that will give you the eccentricity index. So as the RV dysfunction occurs, 1.1 is, I think it is a normal. If it is the transverse diameter divided by the longitudinal diameter, if it is coming very much more than 1.1 or so, you can grade it as a RV dysfunction, and you can grade a mild, moderate, severe depending upon how much difference exists. Exact value I may not able to tell you, but there should be equal, the A and B, that means anteroposterior and the transverse diameters should be same. I think Dr. Muralidhar will talk better on that.
See, eccentricity index specifically looks at the dimensions, lateral dimensions and the length of the LV. And this is an index of the left ventricular dilatation, or it can be taken as a right ventricular dysfunction when the right ventricle is dilated and presses on the left ventricular cavity. This is septum is shifted towards the left,
right side,
and there's D-shaped left ventricle. typically seen in right ventricular failure.
Yes, sir. Yes, that's what I was telling.
No.
There is one question. How do you assess LV function in routine cases?
Sir, we are assessing it by Simpson's method. We are doing it in 4-chamber and 2-chamber view. An average of the two is considered as a LV function. That is a more better estimation, and it is a quick to assess. In some patients, we are using TDI also to add on. Whenever you have regional wall motion abnormalities which are severe in the basal areas of the LV, because as you go from the base towards the apex, in 4-chamber views and 2-chamber view, it looks LV is poor, and when you go into the transgastric mid short axis, apical short axis, and the basal short axis at 3 different levels, LV seems to be different. So if you take always transgastric mid short axis view and do a M mode measurement, it is not always the true value of the LV here. So my suggestion is you should see the volumetric analysis of the 4-chamber and 2-chamber, and then go to the transgastric mid, apical, and basal short axis to see the all the levels the functions of the LV, and then add up together or correlate it with the clinical findings and get the final interpretation or the assumption about the LV function assessment.
Can you explain paradoxical septal motion assessment in M mode?
Paradoxical septal assessment, sir?
Septal motion assessment in M mode.
Paradoxical septal assessment, sir, in mesophageal 4-chamber view, we have to align the line of interrogation parallel to the septum, and then we can put a color M mode, and that can also be depicted in the M mode as a color M mode pattern.
Right. Any other questions? Dr. Sriman, are you there? Dr. Sriman Narayana?
Govinda.
This is a list of conditions which can cause septal bonds, which is left ventral branch block, open cardiac surgery, septal ischemia, pericardial disease, especially constrictive pericarditis, tamponade, and some pulmonary related issues like
right ventricular embolism
and afterload.
Mm.
These things can cause abnormal motion of the septum, that is paradoxical motion of the
paradoxical motion of the septum. Acute pulmonary embolism is a classical example of septal paradox.
Yes, pulmonary embolism one of the cause whenever there is acute increase in the right ventricular afterload.
Yes, sir,
there may be abnormal septal motion. Prabhu, can you conclude this meeting? Because I
can't. Okay, sir. Thanks, today's speaker, Dr. Abhijit, for wonderful explanation of the various aspect of the ventricular function assessment.
Thank you, sir.
It's a wonderful talk, sir. Thank you for.
Sir, segmental wall function, there was no time to cover, so probably I'll extend it to the second part of my talk. Okay, so I'll get back to you with that segmental motion, and then we will subsequently go ahead with the assessment of ischemic MR, assessment of the RV function, and the diastolic function of the LV subsequently in the parts. I have chosen the topic such that we can cover most of the aspects.
Even the aorta.
Yeah, IOTA assessment of IOTA also is there, and other utilities of TE also is there, like placement of ABP.
Because coronary grafting and all will hampers the
yes, sir, also. Yes, sir. So athroma assessment of the calcium, assessment of the placement of the IABP, placement of the PA catheters, placement of the coronary sinus cardioplegia, retrograde cardioplegia, all that I have covered in the subsequent topics. So we will go one by one. Because it is a huge topic, we will convert into a part-wise
fashion. Sir, you please talk to Rajiv and we will reorganize this schedule.
Yes, sir, yes.
What can be done.
Yes, sir.
Thank
yes,
you
sir.
So much. Thank you, Abhijit. Thank you, Sriman. And thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you, and everybody, sir.
Thank you so much. On behalf of Forum of Cardiac Anesthesiologists, I would like to thank all the participants.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Murli.
Thank you so much.